I have mentioned before how difficult preaching can be when my calendar tells me we're supposed to be celebrating more than one important event. Today, for example, it's the day that we celebrate the ascension of the Lord into heaven, and it's Mother's Day. Unless you're Mexican. Because Mexican Mother's Day was Thursday, May the 10th. Same day every year. You don't have to worry about second Sunday or whatever. Much easier, I think. Wait a minute, do Mexican-American mothers get to celebrate twice?
Sí.
Okay, fine. This year, we hear the story of the Ascension from the Gospel according to Luke instead of from the versions recorded in Acts. In Acts, if you will remember, while the disciples are staring up into the sky as Jesus is raised up into the clouds, two men appear and tell them to get back to Jerusalem and wait, as they have been told to do. In this version, they worship him, and they go back to Jerusalem with great joy and no confusion, and they spend all their time in the temple praising God. I don't know about you, but I think I like this version better. Mother's Day, though. Every online clergy group I belong to is filled with warnings about the difficulties of preaching on Mother's Day. Because, well, consider, there are mothers and grandmothers here today who are surrounded by loving families, looking just like all the advertisements on television and the internet. The restaurants will be filled later with happy families taking mom out for dinner so she doesn't have to cook today. Tomorrow it's all back to normal. The flower shops are working overtime and the chocolate industry is ecstatic. Not to mention the manufacturers of household appliances. Nothing says love like a washer dryer. And we all want to celebrate their happiness with them. But for others here, Mother's Day is a reminder of loss. It's a reminder of mothers and grandmothers who have passed or live far away or are in a hospital or a nursing home and are missed on this special day. Some have or had mothers who were not very loving or were abusive or emotionally absent or physically absent. Today might be a painful reminder to some that they are not themselves mothers, or that they lost children. And somehow we preachers have to walk that invisible line to help those who are grieving or getting past their anger, and yet doesn't make the happy families feel guilty about being happy. It really doesn't help when we, the preachers ourselves, fall into the motherless, childless category. For me, it's a little bit like living in Psalm 137, which, for those of you who don't know, is my very favorite psalm of all time. I won't tell you why. But the Hebrews in exile in Psalm 137 cry out, "How can we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? How can we celebrate a day that brings us pain and stresses us out?" In Brian McLaren's book, Naked Spirituality, an example given of God's love is the mother who takes her child's scribbled little drawing and loves it, no matter what it looks like, and hangs it on the refrigerator for all to see for decades to come. For me, that was a really bad example. Because my mother used to take those childish drawings and point out everything that was wrong with them, from color to composition. This was typical of our relationship. She's been gone 26 years now, and I'm finally beginning to heal from my anger and resentment. And now, instead of saying something rude, I can just say, "I don't miss her." Likewise, I am childless, not by choice. And because I was raised to believe as a woman my primary job is to have and raise children, questions about children have been very painful in my life. It's better today, until I began serving in church, I was able to stay home from church on Mother's Day and avoid the pain entirely. But I can't do that anymore. That is not an option today. So I have begun to heal, and I'm grateful for that. I am grateful that God has put me in a situation where I have no choice but to seek healing. This Mother's Day, I am wearing my mother's pearls, which I had not done on Mother's Day ever, in remembrance and for healing. This Mother's Day, I can celebrate with the families who are engaged in joyful celebration while still grieving with those for whom today is filled with pain. I think the disciples must also have been living in a how can we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land moment. After all, they had just said goodbye to Jesus, their Lord, who had been dead and then returned and now is gone again and won't be back. But he's still alive, but he's left them behind. I mean, they watched him go up into the sky to be with the Father, but he left them behind. So I'm sorry, but that's kind of crazy making it stressful, I think. And yet they're celebrating. They worshiped him and they went home in joyful celebration, and they spent all their time in the temple blessing God. Not praising God, blessing God. Not asking to be blessed by God, but blessing God. It seems a little odd, perhaps, because when we ask God for blessing, we're looking to be strengthened and helped and made better in some way. And we can't strengthen or help or make God better with our blessing. But humans can say things to God that let God know we know God is blessed. We can magnify God's name. We can exalt God and speak God's name with gratitude and admiration. So that's what the disciples did. For all the days from the time when Jesus ascended into heaven, they went to the temple every day and raised their voices in acclamation of God's greatness and grace. Sort of like my friend Pastor Joe, who starts pretty much every sentence with, "Praise the living God." They were like that. They were like that all the time, every day in the temple. And remember, these are people who were fearful when Jesus died. These were people who, until Jesus appeared to them after the resurrection, hid away for fear that they too would be taken by the Romans and killed. The day had not yet come to them when the Holy Spirit would fall upon them. That's next Sunday. It hasn't happened yet. But here they are, fearless, in the most public place in Jerusalem, in the temple, every day, lifting up their voices in joyful celebration of what and who God is. Not worrying about whether somebody might recognize them as having been with Jesus. They went to the temple daily, telling God and everybody else present how awesome and wonderful God is. They obeyed Jesus' final instructions to call for humanity's repentance and to proclaim God's forgiveness beginning in Jerusalem. And they began that work by blessing God daily, out loud, in the temple in Jerusalem. We cannot be in the temple or the church every day, all day, to praise God. I'm sure most of us would love to, but we have other things we kind of have to do, like school and, you know, work and taking care of kids and being retired and stuff. But we can lift up God's name in praise wherever we might be. You may not be able to run around saying, "Praise the living God," every place you go. I tend to think that it might be a problem in the classroom and some other places. But we can bless and glorify God with our hearts and with our lips all the days of our lives. For our God is an awesome God and worthy of all praise. My brothers and sisters, let us join in with the disciples in worshiping our Lord out loud. Let us stand and sing. Come, Christians, join to sing.